Hi, let's take 1 minute to discuss about the main goals of this video. We'll learn how to use Python together with QGIS, and we'll answer one very simple question. Yet, along the way, we'll see that there will be a lot of problems, and at the end of the day, you're spending more time solving those problems instead of doing your job. So, what I want to show you is not all those simple tricks. I want you to have a rough idea of the broad range of possibilities that are offered when you mix together Python and QGIS. This video will be fast but won't be short, so hold tight, and either if you are a student, a data analyst or a geographer, I hope you will be able to learn some stuff. And if you have any comments, please write me, as it's the first time I'm doing a tutorial, so any feedback will be appreciated. If not already done, please install the last distribution of QGIS and Anaconda. In Anaconda you will find Spider, which is I think the best free IDE for data analysis. Notice that the air pollution data is the only one dataset you will not be able to find on the internet for free. So if you want to follow along, in the description I included a link with a similar dataset. Because it won't be the same exact dataset, you will have to edit a few variables names and you will have to work around your own problems. So here is the amazing air pollution dataset I have been given. It's a computer simulation of daily NO2 levels, as you can see, centered on Europe. Of course, we can zoom in to get a rough idea of the resolution and scale of the dataset, but we can also enable the value tool to quickly get an access to each day's value. My boss is studying air pollution since a few decades and she has a clear idea of what she wants, so she asked me to give her how much of each country for each day is going above the threshold of 40. Since I don't have any clue on how to do it, I go in the processing toolbox and type for Raster. Then I find I have the Raster calculator, and let's see what does this window allows me. So I can select one layer and do one operation. So let's say I want to do above 40. The expression is not valid and I don't have any clue why. But this is not the main problem. Since I want to do this operation on 4 months, I will have to use it as a batch process. What do I see? Well, even though there is 121 layer, right now QGIS does not allow me to select each individual layer and do the same operation on it. And even if I could do that, because each layer have a different name, I would still have to type in manually each layer's name. QGIS expects us to provide it one file per day. So we're gonna simply open the NetCDF file on Python and slice it into 121 layer that we're gonna export again. Simple. Back in Spider, the first thing I'm doing is importing Xarray. This library is just super useful if you're working with NetCDF data. I'm not too fond of the documentation because I think it do lacks a bit more examples. As a beginner, sometimes you feel overwhelmed by the quantity of information and you need to focus on what's essential. So what do we need here? We want to know how to import a file, then how to get the information contained in each day, and then how to export it back to a new file. So what I did is I first used Open Dataset to import the dataset. I then created a series of dates going from the 1st January to the 30th of April, and then in a loop where each iteration points to each day, I extracted the data for each day. What I can see is inside the NetCDF there's lat2 and long2 that are variables that I really don't need, so I dropped it. Then I saved every day's back into a new NetCDF file using the date into the name of the file. You may be wondering, how did I knew that I had to drop lat2 and long2? This is thanks to Xarray. It allowed me to look inside the NetCDF, look inside the variables, and understand that those ones are really not useful. The only thing QGIS needs is my NO2 data, referenced by time, lat, and long. This is what we get here, so it's perfectly fine. We can totally export without lat2 and long2. And this type of simple mistakes may be common if you're working with exotic datasets, like the one we are working on today. We are back in QGIS, and in batch process we can now select our 121 files that we just created. But wait, we have to type in the expression, and there's no way I'm typing 121 formulas. You're gonna press Ctrl+Alt+P, and the Python console will show up. If you click here, you're gonna get a text editor where you can run scripts from. You're gonna open the raster calculator again. You're gonna select the layer you need, You're gonna type the expression. Notice that this time it's working, possibly because we dropped useless variables. And you're gonna run it. It should be working right away. And once it's working for you, you're gonna go to processing and history. You're gonna click on the first line. It's the last operation you did. And you're gonna copy this text. So it's, of course, the command of the last thing you ran. So we want to run this command 121 times. So let's copy it and take it back to Spider. We're gonna take a look at it. Processing.run, QGIS raster calculator, makes sense. Then we have our expression and we see right away there's a date that was in the layer's name. So we will have to turn this into a variable. Then we point into the NetCDF file containing this layer. And of course, in the NetCDF file name, there's also a date. So this will have to be a variable too. Then we have the extent and the CRS, which we don't need to edit. And finally, the output. So we're gonna input also the date as a variable to the output. So you see simply, I take my series of date as before. I do exactly the same thing as before. And I'm gonna run this thing multiple times. However, of course, from Spider, I can't control QGIS, so I'm gonna copy it and paste it back to the QGIS text editor where I can run the script. And now click run, and as you're seeing, it's creating 121 TIFF files automatically. Awesome. So now I have for each day one image file which contains for each cell if the daily average value is above or below 40. Now I will do a quick Google search to download the world country boundaries. Look into its attribute table. It's where we're gonna add the sum and the count. And before we post you will have to create a copy of the file to S3 shape files. This is required, otherwise you will not be able to add data into this table. I will search for Zonal statistics. And notice that this time we'll be able to use the batch processing. Regarding the statistics to calculate, we'll keep the count and the sum. I want to be able to know how many cells can be positive in the country. Then I will be able to estimate how much of the percentage of the country is actually above the determined threshold. Now that we filled all parameters, let's click run. The algorithm will approximately take 10 minutes, so let's speed up the process. In the attribute table, I will now find one new column per day. Let's export this table to a CSV. Let's get back on Spider, and you can see that I have a predefined list of countries of interest. In the CSV table we've just exported, there's really much more data than just one row per country. For each country of interest, in the table, we're gonna select all the data relative to this country. Let me try to tell you what's going on in this loop. For each country of interest, we are taking all available data, and we're putting it the data per country variable. As I told you earlier, it's possible to have multiple rows per country. So each time I'm checking if data per country is either a data frame or a series. If I do get a data frame, it simply means I have multiple rows for the selected country. So I'm going to sum them all. In the variable data, we put the sum of white cells per country. Finally, in the DF result data frame, we are going to save for each day and each country the percentage of white cells. Let's export the data frame and the job is done. Congrats! So the table is really only what's needed to do the analysis. However, since we have so much image files, I thought why not make a video with those? And while most tutorials will tell you to make a GIF file or to use the integrated function in QGIS, I will try to show you how I do it my way. First, we're going to convert all those TIFF files into more manageable JPEG files using Photoshop. And we're going to use DaVinci Resolve, which is, without any doubt, the best free video editing software available. We're just going to edit this parameter in the software so that each image we are dropping in the project is seen as one video frame. Don't you think it would be great if we were also displaying the date as we were displaying the result? So after doing a 2-minute web search, I found how to generate it automatically using Python. By generating a new set of frames, it allows us to place it and scale it wherever we want. Notice how you can change blending mode and opacity. Let's make a quick export. Looks good. So thanks for watching and see you later.